thank you for coming. It is really great honor for me to be in the company of legendary film director Mr. Kazuo Hara. Mr. Hara, welcome to Belgrade, first of all. How do you feel here? Do you enjoy?
とても落ち着いた文化が成熟した雰囲気が伝わってとてもいい街だなと思っています。
I think I really enjoyed Belgrade. I think it's the place where culture is developing and still believed by the people. So it's very calm and I really enjoyed the time in Belgrade.
You started your film career at the beginning of the 90s. It was one of the most interesting period after Second World War in political and cultural history of Japan. Please be so kind and tell us about your early film days in larger context, political, ideological, and cinematographical.
The answer will be a bit longer, so please stay with me.
いいんですか? Okay. 私は1945年生まれです。つまり日本が戦争に負けた年に生まれました。
So, I was born in 1945, the year when Japan lost the war.
戦争が負けて日本に民主主義が導入されました。
So the Japan lost the war, and as a result of that, the democracy was introduced to Japan.
で、日本の中に民主主義が根付いていく過程と、私が成長していく過程とシンクロしていたんだって、今になって思います。
So, when I turn back to my life,the democracy and me has the same path of development. So we were raised at the same time and we were synchronized, democracy and my life.
で、私は日本の中の山口県という地方で、ずっと育ちました。
So I was raised in Yamaguchi Prefecture, which is kind of a province in it's an urban area in Japan.
ですから田舎にいるときは、政治のこととか世の中のこととか人間が生きるとはどういうことであるとかについて全く考えたことがなかった。
So in my childhood, since I was in that small area, living in very rural area, I was raised not thinking much about politics of how I live my life and other things.
そして大人になって、さて自分は、職業を選ばないといけないということで、報道写真家になろうと思ってですね、東京に出て、写真を学ぶ学校に入ったわけです。
So when I was thinking about my future and my occupation, what I would like to be, I thought that maybe I would like to become a photojournalist. So I went from the small region to capital Tokyo, and I started to learn photography.
二十歳の時でした。
That was when I was 20.
で、東京に出てしばらくして3、4年経って、世界的に若い人たちの学生運動が、起きました。日本では全教徒運動といいまして、大学生たちが、決起したわけですね。
So, three or four years passed after I moved to Tokyo. And in that, at that time, there was a strong student movement, as well as in other parts of the world. It was called Zen Kyoto movement in Japan, and students started to rebel.
私は大学生でもありませんし、労働者でもないので、運動の仲間になるってことはないんですよね。ただそういう学生の連中がそういう運動をした、なんて言うんでしょうか、こうそばをでこう見てる彼らの運動を、それでとてもとてもとても大きな刺激を受けました。
So, at that time I wasn't a student and neither I was a labor worker. So I would just, stand on a side and I would watch what they're doing, and that was very impressive.What they were doing, and it has a huge impact on my life.
で、70年代です、時はね、その時は。
That was in 1970s.
で、これは私の考えですが、70年というのは、70年代というのは、戦後民主主義的な、言ってみれば、価値を持った文化がね、一気に開いた時期だろうと思うんです。
If you ask me, 1970s was the period where the culture which has the values of democracy just bloomed instantly.
日本の監督でいうと大島渚とか、今村翔平とか、そういう日本世界の巨匠というふうに言われるようになるんですが、その監督たちがとても意欲的な作品を発表してました。
So, when it comes to the movies, it was a period of the world famous directors such as Oshima Nagisa or Imamura Shohei who were making very impressive movies at that time.
それまで映画というのは映画会社っていうのがあって、映画会社の企画にのっとって映画が作られた、プログラムピクチャーと言います。
That was the period of so-called program picture, which means that they were companies which were making movies. They were strictly planned their movies, and the movies were made strictly according to that plan.
それに対してですね、70年代に、ATG って言いますけど、アートシアターギルドっていう名前で、小さな会社なんですが、その会社が500万出すと、で監督が500万出すと、で1000万円で映画を作ろうという新しい映画運動が起きたんです。
The new company called ATG, which means Art Theater Guild,was founded at that time, and they started this new kind of program of financing the movies. 500 million of yens would put by that company, and the same amount would be invested by the director of the movie.
それで私たち若い人はそのアートシアターの映画を見るというのが、つまり文化の一つの流行っていう言葉を使うと誤解があるんですが、若い人はみんなその ATG の映画を見るというような雰囲気があったんですね。
And movies were made by that company, ATG's. And it is a bit wrong to say that it was popular or it was trendy at that time, but the young people would go to the theater to watch the movies made by the ATG.
で、美術の世界でも、言葉をちょっと忘れたけど、ボディーペインティングとかパフォーマンスとかね、新しい動きが出たのは70年代。
And also in the world of visual art, I don't know how to say properly, but it was the time when the body painting was very popular, and also the performance as an art form was made at that time.
そんな空気の中で、なんて言いますか、社会とは何か、人間とは何かということを考え始めたのはまさにそういう時代です。
So that was the period when I started to really deeply think about what is the society and what is our life.
それで私がなぜドキュメンタリーを志すようになったのか。
So I would like to start to talk about why I started to make documentaries film.
さよなら CP という映画を、ご覧になった方は分かると思いますが、私の映画のプロデューサーは小林という女性です。
If you know my first movie, Goodbye CP,you maybe know that the producer of that movie was a lady, and her name is Kobayashi Sachiko.
はい。で、私は報道写真家になろうとしてたんですが、私のプロデューサー、つまり私の奥さんでもある人なんですが、その奥さんが映画を作りたかった。だけど彼女は障害者だから、一人じゃなかなか映画ができないと。誰か一緒にやってくれる人はいないかと探してたわけです。
Kobayashi, the producer, and later my wife, she wanted to make documentary movies. At that time, I was still a photojournalist, so she asked me for help because she was also like handicapped. So she asked me for help to help her make the movie.
それでですね、実は私は、東京に出て4年間障害者の問題をやってたんですが、東京の銀座で写真展、個展をやったんですよね。その個展にその小林という、女性が、その時は初めての対面ですが、写真展を見に来てた彼女が、この写真展、つまりフォトグラファーは私ですから、私に話しかけてきたんです。
4 years after when I arrived to Tokyo, for 4 years I used to take photos of people with some physical problems, disabilities. After 4 years I organized an photo exhibition in Tokyo.And that lady, Kobayashi, came to the exhibition, and that was actually the first time we met. So she saw like my photos, and she was very interested in my work.
で、彼女がですね、私に話しかけて、まあいろんな話をまあしたわけですが、そしてですね、彼女が私と一緒に映画をやってくれないかと。言われたわけです。
So she started to talk to me, and that was our first conversation. And after a while, during that conversation, she asked me whether if I will be willing to help her in making a movie.
それでですね、さよなら CP じゃなくて局地的エロスって映画を見た人はお分かりだと思いますが、出会った頃は彼女はとても小柄なんですよね。背が低くて、それでとても美人だった。はい、
So, if you saw my second movie, Extremely Private Harris, maybe you saw a lady Kobayashi. She's very small and she's very beautiful.
で、美人の人から一緒に映画をやってくれないかと言われたんで、私はイエスと答えたわけです。
So, since she was so beautiful,I couldn't resist and say no to her when she requested me for help for, to make a
movie. So
that was the first turning point in my life. Until then, together we made all our movies together.
Yeah. I'm curious to know, did you participate in any kind of political activities?Have you ever been a member of any political party in Japan?
原監督は今まで、まあ、そういう政治的な運動に関わったことはありますか？もしくは政党に入るとかそういうことはありましたか？
20代、まあ、東京出て障害者の人たちの映画写真を撮ってた時に、なんていうか小さな運動なんだけど、小さな運動に参加したことがあるんですよ。で、その経験から、日本のですよ、日本の共産党から、 共産党員にならないかって誘われたことはあります。
So when I was in my 20s, I used to take photos of people and with disabilities, and I was involved in some kind of activities related to that. And at that time, probably Japanese Communist Party sent me the invitation to join their party.
誘われましたが、あの日本共産党の人たちはとても規律に厳しいんですよね。つまり、約束を破ってはいけないとか、清潔にしなさいとか、そういうなんて言うんだろう、規律があのとても厳しくてですね、その頃はそういうこの規律というものに対して反感を持ってたから、若い自分ね。でこんなにあの厳しくいろいろ言われるんだったらやめとこうと思って入らなかったです。
Japanese Communist Party was known at that time as a party with very strict rules and formalities. For instance, you have to dress really sharp, you have to behave like this and that. So there was too many rules. At that time, I didn't like those rules very much, so I rejected their invitation.
But one of your very famous colleagues, Adachi Masao, was obsessed with Japanese Red Army. What about you? You didn't have a sympathy for them?
Tadashi Masao 監督はい、はあのまあ赤軍に非常に興味を持ってたんですけど、原監督は赤軍に対してどういう思いでしょうか？
過激な生き方をしたいと思ってましたから、足立正雄が当時あのこちらにね、アレスさんが来ていろいろ政治運動をやってるということはあの支援をしてて、そういう映画を作りたいというふうにやってたことは知ってましたので、基本的にはあのなんかあの気持ちとしては同感できるんですが、ただその政治に介入するっていうところまでいかないんです。やっぱり映画を作りたかったからね。
So the director Adachi, he was making those kind of movies, and I was really interested in all those people who lived radical or extreme kind of way of life. So I was interested. I had sympathy. I helped him. I also assisted on his movies.But it didn't go to that point that I wanted to get into the world of politics.
For many of us, it was the third golden age for Japanese cinema. Nobuo Bago, or Japanese New Wave, were very active members at that time, and people like Koji Watsamatsu, Yoshishige Yoshida, Masahiro Shinoda. I'm interested on their influence on your work.Did you respect them all? Yoshishige Yoshida, Koji Wakamatsu, Masahiro Shinoda, and all these guys?
まあ、当時あの日本では、まあ、ニューウェーブ。
They were members of one very radical film movement. We used to call it Nobuo Bago or New Wave.
Nobuo Bago.のまあ監督方、まあ、非常にあの急進的な映画を作ってた、はい、あのまあ監督がいますけど、はい、まあ、そういったあの監督らの作品にはまあ感銘を受けたり、インスピレーションを受けたりしたことはありますか？は
い、あの日本のヌーベルバーグという劇映画ドキュメンタリーもかかわらずね、まあ、劇映画がほとんど多かったけど、日本のヌーベルバーグという映画運動っていうか、が一番影響を受けたものだと思います。
Yes, I was really inspired. Although those movies are drama movies, it's not from the world of documentary, but they really inspired me.
You always criticize documentary filmmakers in Japan. According to you, they are not radical. Are you on the same line?
あのまあ、原監督はよくあの日本のドキュメンタリー映画監督が、まああのまあ、十分に過激でないっていう、まあ、批判をよくされてますけど、
よく知ってますね。
はい、 So he's you're very well informed. そういったあの批判は今でも続いてますか？
私たちは70年代の時に青春時代だったね。
So we were in our like juvenile years in 70s.
で私の一つ上の世代に大島渚とか今村翔平とかもちろん篠田さんがいて、とにかく60年代の監督たちっていうのは私から見るととても大きな存在だっていうふうに見えてた。
So, we were at that time impressed with the directors from 60s like Oshima Nagisa or Imamura Shohei. So we were really look up to them as like role models for us.
だから日本には世界に知られた黒澤明とか小津安二郎とか監督がいますが、その監督たちは大島さんたちよりさらにもう一つ上でしょ。
So in the world, the Japanese directors who are really famous are like Akira, Kurosawa Akira or Yasujiro Ozu. Those are directors from 50s, so that's the generation before the Imamura Shohei and others.
で私たちの世代というのは一つ上の世代の人たちの映画を見て学んで、その映画を超えようと、超えなきゃいけないんだっていうふうに考えてたんですね。
So the perception among movie directors in 70s was that we are all inspired by the directors from 60s, but we in the 70s have to make better movies and come over their influence.
で、私たちの世代からこう下になっていくとですね、私から見たときに、なんか日本人が持ってるエネルギーがどんどんね弱くなっていってるっていうか、80年代、90年代、2021世紀となっていくでしょ。Mm-hmm. どんどんねエネルギー自体がね弱くなってる。
So, for us, with that perception, later in 80s, 90s, and in the beginning of 21st century, we felt that directors from that period had like really lower energy than we used to have. So, as the time passed from 80s until these days, the energy was just going lower and lower.
だから日本の戦後の何て言いますか、文化の持ってるこう豊かさは多分私の意見ですが、70年代がピーク、あとは少しずつね何て言うかピークのあとは腐敗していくじゃないですか。でどんどんエネルギーがもう弱まっていった歴史だろうというふうに思ってます。
So if you ask me, the culture, the post-war culture started to flourish in50s, and the peak was someone in the 70s in our time, and after that, of course, after the peak comes a downhill. So after that, pretty much and anything related to culture just went downhill.
But what about eminent documentary filmmakers like Shunsuke Ogawa from the 60s or Tochimoto or maybe Akira Iwasaki?Did they have any influence on your work later?
60年代に、
I think they were very, very good and very important film documentary film directors.
Akira Iwasaki, Akira とか、小川俊介などの60年代の、まあ、有名なドキュメンタリー、今どういう、
yes.
思いを
日本のドキュメンタリーの歴史から、おそらくは、多くの人が認めるであろうこう突出して仕事をした監督はっていうと小川慎介っていう人と、土本紀明っていう監督なんですね。
So when it comes to those eminent directors from the 60s, we have directors like Ogawa Shinsuke and Tsuchimoto Noriaki, who are really making those established documentary movies.
Ogawa-san の三立化、三立、成田空港反対闘争。
The movie of Ogawa, which was picturing the one accident in Narita Airport when the revolutionaries started to attack and occupy the Narita Airport.
Ogawa Production の新しい三立館シリーズの映画が完成して上映会があると。だそれをもう待ってたかのように映画館に駆けつけてもう夢中で見てた。
So I was at that time, I heard the news that Ogawa Production will release that movie in a theater. So we were all like running to the theater to see it, and I was so looking forward. And when I entered the theater, I was like completely 100% concentrated and focused on that movie.
だから劇映画もたくさん見てましたけれども、ドキュメンタリーを作るようになって、小川慎介、土本範明という2人の監督が作った映画を自分は必ず超えてみせるというのが私の決意でした。
So, I was watching a lot of drama movies at that time, but when I see the documentary movies,from Ogawa Shinsuke and Tsuchinori Noriaki, I just felt that I have to do that and that I have to do that better than they are doing it.
その気持ちは今も続いてます。
And I still have that passion.
According to Japanese standard, your first movie, Sayonara CP, was success or not?
あのね、完成した当時ものすごく反感を買いました。
First, when I released that movie, I was an object of really severe critics.
なぜかというとですね、昨日一昨日かここでお話ししましたけれど、私のカメラがですね、脳性麻痺の主人公たちに対してとても暴力的だった。
So I talked about that 2 days ago here. The main critique was that my camera pointing at the subject of my movies, the people who have a cerebral palsy, was too aggressive.
で、それは私は無自覚にやったわけじゃなくて、意図的に暴力的にカメラを駆使すると。いうふうに考えたからです。
So, that was not my unconscious action. I deliberately used that way to shoot that movie.
日本ではその頃まではですね、やっぱり弱者に対してね、強者である健全者って言いますが、同じ人間じゃないかと。同じ人間に対してもう少しこう優しくしようじゃないかっていう考え方のドキュメンタリーがとてもたくさん作られてたんです。
So, when it comes to the documentary, especially the documentaries which are dealing with subject of people with disabilities or minorities, there was always a pattern of making a documentary at that time, like, okay, they have disabilities, poor them, they're victims, so we have to treat themas a human being, we who are, let's say, normal. So that was the usual pattern of shooting documentary on that subject.
同じ人間じゃないかって言われてもね、もう最初からまさか犬や豚や牛だっていうふうに思うわけないんであって、同じ人間じゃないかっていう考え方の、ヒューマニズムっていう言葉を使いますが、そのなんていうか欺瞞にですね、私はとても怒りを覚えたので、そういうものを全部ぶっ壊しちゃいっていうふうに考えたんです。
So there was a stereotype phrase like, okay, let's treat them as human beings. So that means that If you say let's treat them as human beings, that means there is a prediction that they are not human beings. So they're same as like pigs, dogs, and other animals. So I wanted to crush that stereotype.
で、そういうあの私の気持ちが画面に出ますからね。
And I was fierce about that, and I wanted to fiercely to destroy that stereotype. So that kind of my personal expression was shown in the aesthetics of the movie.
だから映画を見た人がですね、映画を作る人たちは私のことですが、映画を作る人たちは障害者に対してこんな暴力的なことをする権利があるのかっていう反感を買ったんです。
So the criticism of my movies was based on do I or do we who are making that movie do we have the right to do such an awful and aggressive things to the subject of our movie who are the people with disabilities。
でもね、2年経って私の気持ちというものがこう見る人にこう伝わっていってね。変わりましたよ。
So it took two years for the perception of the public to change the perception of me and my feelings towards that towards making of that movie.
だから、世の中の持ってる障害者に対する価値観をさようなら CP は間違いなく1ページをこうめくる。
So I think that my movie Goodbye CP changed the way of perception of the people with disabilities. I think I really turned one page and changed the perception, general perception of the people and with the disabilities.
Did exist at that time well organized distribution system for documentaries?
当時 の, その、まあ、ドキュメンタリー映画の配給、というか、まあ、見せ場の、まあ、体制は当時は整ってました。
いえ、今はですよ、今、私たちのようなマイナーな映画、ドキュメンタリーも含めてマイナーな映画を、上映するという、日本ではそういう映画館をミニシアターって呼んでますけれども、日本の各地にミニシアターが結構な数があります。で、このミニシアターが興行として成り立つというふうに、そのきっかけを作ったのが「雪来て新軍」って映画なんです。
So, we in Japan we call them mini theaters. Those are small movie theaters who will play those minor moviesSuch as a documentary movies and those other minor genre of movies. And the turning point in the making of that kind of a distribution potential for the documentary movies was made by this movie Emperor Naked Army Still Marching On.
つまりその前まではですね、さよなら CP も局地的ロス、コヨタ1974も私たちは自主上映って言ってましたけれど、公民館を借りて自分たちの手で上映をするという形だった。
So before the movie, this documentary movie, Emperor Naked Armies, so there was no distribution system for documentary. So both Goodbye CP and Extremely Private Eros,my first two movies, they were, the release of these movies were organized by us, and we would rent some hall where we can like screen the movie, and we would print the tickets, sell the tickets, and we were pretty much self-independently organized the screening of the movies.
I'm interested for your relationship with official channels of Japanese television.
原監督は、まあ日本の、まあ、民放とか、NHK とかどういった関係を持ってますか、その映画の面では。
日本の、なんていうか、映画とテレビの関係っていうのは世界が全く違うんだよね。
In Japan, the world of television and the world of movies is completely separated.
だから映画の人がテレビで作品を作るってことはないし、テレビの人が映画を作るってことはないです。全く今は少しあります。
So in last period there are some cases whensomeone from the world of movie makes something for television and vice versa, but generally it is completely different world. So there are no chance for someone who are making movie to work for the program for the television, and also there are no chance for the television program director to work in the world of movie.
There is one legendary interview, very long interview with you by Kenneth Roof in United States. And he always used to say, I am very poor filmmaker. I am an outlaw in Japanese film industry. Is that true?
米国で原監督がインタビュー、されたと思うんですけど、
Kenneth Roof。
ケネス・スルっていう方のインタビューで、
According to Mr. Hara, he is a very poor filmmaker and he feels like the outlaw in Japanese film industry.
で、そのインタビューで原監督が私は非常に貧しい監督ですが、はい、日本の、映画界では、なんていうんですか、アウトロー、であるということをおっしゃいましたね、はい、っていう、はい、それは今でもそうですか。
今でもスーパー貧乏です。
The only difference is that now I'm super poor.
さよなら CP っていう映画は小林と映画を作ろうということになって、はい、誰もお金を出してくれるわけがないので小林がアルバイトしてたんですよね、生協みたいなところで。で、今日は給料日だと。で、給料もらってくるじゃん。アルバイトだからそんな多くないよね。で、その給料全部フィルムを買って、原さんこれで映画を撮ろうよ。
So, just to explain the conditions, when we started to make the Goodbye CP, Kobayashi, my wife, the producer of the film, back then she used to work a part-time job. So, on the day of the payment, she would bring the money, and since it was a part-time job, it's not a big money, but she would buy the films with itsmall money she had, and she would bring me the films and she said, okay, let's make the movie.
今まで作った映画は、全部、戦乱だけはちょっと違うんですが、それまでは全部借金をして映画を作る。で、完成したらそれを上映をして、その収入から借金を返すというサイクルなんですが、ね、ヒットすればいいけどヒットしない映画もあるわけで、そうすると借金返すのがもう大変じゃないですか。
So basically the cycle of financing our movies was we would get the loan for the movie, and after the screening if the movie is a hit then we would easily pay back the money to the loaner.But it was very tragical when it is not the hit, so it would be very difficult for us to pay back the loan. The situation with the asbestos movies, Senen movie is a bit different, but basically it was the cycle of financing our movie.
Shohei Imamura, one of the greatest Japanese film directors, was producer on Japanese Naked Army. How did you arrange this collaboration with him? Did he push you in film?
いや、違います。新軍って映画はね、奥崎さんが昭和天皇の あの日本では天皇が正月の2日の日に国民に向かってこう新年の挨拶をするというセレモニーがあるわけね、必ずね。
So it's not true. I will explain the situation. So Okuzaki, the main character in this movie, there's an event each new year, the 2nd of January, when the emperor gets in front of the public to give some speech.
で、その正月の2日の日に奥崎健三という人が昭和天皇とこう手を振っているところにこうパチンコ玉、パチンコ玉って分かります？発射したんです。うん。
So on the 2nd of January, when Emperor came in front of the public and he was waving the hands, Okuzaki just pulled out the, how do you say that? Slingshot, and he just shoot on the Emperor.
で、発射したパチンコ玉は天皇に当たってないんですよ。天皇が手を振ってる遥か手前にポトンと落ちたと。
So he couldn't make that distance with that slingshot, so he would shoot, but those balls just fell in front, far from the emperor. He didn't hit the emperor.
だけど奥崎さんは逮捕されて裁判になりました。
But Mr. Okuzaki was arrested, of course. And there was a trial on that case.
で、今村さんと今村プロの人たちはこの奥崎さんが起こした事件というのはとっても大きな意味があると、これを映画にしなければならないと考えて映画を作ろうとした。
So, 今村翔平 director and the production team of his, they saw that event and they said that it's a very significantevent for someone to shoot the emperor, so they decided to make a movie about that.
それで、奥崎さんは裁判をやってるので、法廷の中にカメラを持ち込んで奥崎さんを撮影しようとした。
So the first idea was to get into the court and to shoot those trials.
で、だけども日本の法廷っていうのは撮影は絶対に OK が出ません。
But according to the laws in Japan, it was strictly prohibited to record or shoot any trials in a courtroom.
そこで今村プロの人たちは、ある作戦を練ったと。つまり隠しカメラを隠して法廷の中に持ち込んで、奥崎さんが出廷したらカメラマンはカメラを取り出して、ね、撮影しちゃえと。それで今村プロのスタッフが何人かいて裁判長ってわーってこう騒ぎを起こして、その隙に回しちゃえという作戦を立てたわけ。
So the strategy for shooting inside the courtroom was the Imamura, director Imamura and his team would hide the cameras in bags.And they were sneaking into the courtroom, and they were just start to making a mess in a courtroom when Mr. Okuzaki would enter the courtroom, and they would use that chance of chaos to shoot the atmosphere in the courtroom and shoot Okuzaki in the courtroom.
それで奥崎さんがさて出てきました。で、カメラマンはカメラを取り出して撮影しようとした。ただし、その時用意したカメラがね、ゼンマイ式カメラ、皆さんゼンマイ式カメラって知ってますか？
So the only thing was when Mr. Okuzaki entered the courtroom and the cameraman took out the camera, but it was not automatic camera, it needed to be like how do you say to wind up the mechanism.
それでカメラマンがシャッターボタンを押したら、そのゼンマイの音がね、ジャーッと音がしたんですよ。もうすぐバレちゃって、裁判長が大抵って出されちゃった。
So when he pressed the shutter, it just made, started to make the noise because it was wind up. So it was like making a huge noise. So the judge suddenly, he saw the camera and he just stopped the proceeding and quit the trial.
でその他にもいろいろカメラを隠しカメラを作ったらいろいろしたんだけど全部うまくいかないと。
So after that they tried many times with different kind of hidden cameras to shoot the process in a courtroom, but they did it was always unsuccessful.
それで、これはもう撮影ができないということで。今村さんは奥崎さんの映画を作ることを断念します。
So, after those multiple failures in shooting the courtroom, they just decided to quit shooting a movie about Mr. Okuzaki.
それで、10年という時間が経ちます。
And 10 years after that,
で私は今村翔平さん監督の A じゃないかっていうあの海外のイングリッシュタイトルは分からないんだけども今村翔平 の, あの作品の現場で撮影助手として働いてたんです。
So I was assistant director for Mr. Imamura for that period.
で、ある日天気待ちって分かります晴れの日に撮りたい。だけど曇ってる。だから晴れるまで待とうという。
So one day we were on a standby at the location of shooting. It was a bad weather, so we were waiting for the sun to come out so we can continue with shooting. So we were in standby.
それで寒い日だったので、ドラム缶に薪をくべてこう火当たってた。
So it was a very cold day, so we just put some wood in some barrel and we were just warming our hands.
で、私の目の前に今村さんがいて、世間話。
And Imamura director was present at that point, so we were just like chatting.
そして私が、面白いドキュメンタリーを作りたいんですよねって言った。
And Imamura said, I just want to make one interesting documentary.
それを聞いて今村さんが、お、そうか、面白い男がいるんだが、紹介してあげようって。
So actually, I said, I wanted to make an interesting documentary movies, and Imamura said, Oh, I know very interesting person, so I can introduce that person to you.
で、今村さんが神戸に住んでる奥崎さんに電話をしてね、原君という若い、人を紹介します。
And he gave the phone call to Mr. Okuzaki, and he said that there's one young director, Hara, and I want to just make a connection between you and him.
で新幹線に乗って神戸の奥崎さんに会いに行った。
So we went to Kobe to meet Okuzaki. We went on a bullet train.
で、会った、その日ですね、挨拶します。朝おはようございます。よろしくお願いします。
So it was morning, so I told him like, good morning, thank you for having us.
そしたら一気に、ね、奥崎さんが自分のことをね。とうとうと語り始めたんです。
And he didn't answer anything, but he just started to talk about himself.
7時間、ノンストップ。
For 7 hours non-stop, he was talking about himself.
で、私は本当覚えてますが、何も意見は言いませんでした。
So I was just listening to him. I just didn't have the time to comment anything.
私が一言も。
So I was just like making noises like oh yeah.
それですっかり圧倒されてで帰りの新幹線に私のプロデューサーと一緒に行ったんです。
So I went with my producer on that meeting and I was so like overwhelmed by his presence and when producer and I when we started to go back to Tokyo.
でプロデューサーと 奥崎さんという人を映画に撮る撮らないどうするって二人で
So we were just discussing about the possibility to make a movie about Mr. Okazaki, whether we should do it or not.
で、私の読みだと、今村翔平っていうのはもうグランプリカンヌでもらってたからね、巨匠なわけで、その巨匠がよ、若手の私にね、奥崎さんに会いに行ってみないかって言ったんだからさ、制作費は今村プロが出してあげるからということだろうと思ってた。
So, what I was thinking at that time, since Imamura director, he already won some Grand Prix in Europe. So, when he said to me, when he told me that I should meet Mr. Okazaki, probably he thought that, okay, Imamura production will finance this movie, so that's why he introduced me, so he can finance my work with Mr. Okazaki.
Sayonara CP という曲してケロスは自分たちで借金して作った映画なんで、お金を返すのは大変な思いをしてるので、ね、横崎さんの映画は今村プロがお金を出してくれるんだから、初めてのことだから。絶対よしそれならやろうよっていうふうに相談したんです。
So what I was discussing with my producer was that for Goodbye CP and Extremely Private Heiress, we would take a loan to finance our movie and really had a bad time giving back that paying back that loan. So I was kind of happy because it was the first time for me to think that. Some production house will give me the money to finance my movie, and that's the situation I couldn't reject.
で、翌日、今村プロに挨拶に行ってきました。今村さんに会った。
So next day I went to director Imamura just to say hello.
で、いろいろ説明をして、で、今村さんがそれでお前やるか。
So I explained him about the meeting and everything, and Imamura just asked me, "Okay, are you going to do that movie or not?"
で、私はですね、力を込めてやりますって言ったんです。
So I gave him a strong answer, like, "Yes, I will do it."
そしたらその直後にね、今村さんが、そうか。それでお前お金はどうするんだって聞かれたんです。
So Imamura director was impressed with my answer, but the next moment he asked me, okay, that's good, but what you're going to do about the money?
で、私は今村さんがお金を出してくれるものとばっかり思い込んでたんだよね。
So I was constantly thinking that Imamura director will pay for my movie.
だからお金はどうするんだって言われてね、日本語で今日疲れるって言うでしょ。え？と思ったわけ。
So I was surprised when he asked me what I'm going to do with money because I was thinking that he's going to pay for the cost.
で、その時にね、今は思うんだけど、話が違いますって言えばよかったものをやりますってかっこよく言っちゃったもんだから、お金出してくれませんかと言えなかった。
So since I gave him the strong answer, yes, I will do it, I really couldn't tell him like, okay, I was thinking that you are going to pay.
やりますって言っちゃったからもう引けないからね。で、しょうがないんで、はい、お金も作りますって言ってしまったんだよ。
So since I said yes, I just told him,Okay, I will find a way to make the budget for the movie.
それで、そしたら今村さんが、お、そうか、頑張れよって言っておしまい。
So, 今村さん said, okay, that's good. Good luck with the movie. And that's pretty much it about that.
で、暗い気持ちになって家へ帰って、プロデューサーの小林にね、私が飛んだ早とちり勘違いしたわけでしょ。で、しまった、これ勘違いしたんだよ、今村プロお金出してくれないんだよってプロデューサーの小林に言ったわけです。
So I went home pretty much disappointed and really dark in my soul, because I found out that we are not having a budget for the movie from Imamura Productions. So I went back home, sat with Kobayashi, my producer, and I tell her that I was just thinking wrong, that Imamura Productions will finance our project.
その話を聞いてですね、小林が私にあんたバカねって言われて、でもね、いいわよ、私映画お金作るからやろうよって言ったんです。
So, Kobayashi said, oh, you're stupid again. And she said, don't worry, we'll find a way, I will find a way to find the money for this movie.
で、映画の中にタイトル企画って書いて、企画今村翔平。
So in the titles of the movie, you will see that the movie is planned by Imamura Shohei.
で、Imamura さんからは、なんていうか、何の手伝いもしてもらってませんか。
But in reality, Imamura director didn't help me about anything on this movie.
奥崎さんと出会いさせてくれた。ということの感謝を込めて企画今村翔平という名前を私の方から入れたんです。
So I just put that plan produced by 今村翔平 just to express the gratitude to Mr. 今村 for introducing me to Mr. 奥崎。
長くなりましたか。
I'm sorry, it was a really long story.
No, thank you. According to international standards,The Emperor was an enormous success. After that, your career as a filmmaker enormously growing up. Since then, you are a canonical film director. For example, Errol Morris, legendary American documentary filmmaker, put The Emperor on his private list of 5 best documentary films of all time. I would like to know, does exist some kind of Japanese documentary film stream or movement?Or individual author or successor of work of Mr. Kazuo Hara.
Hara 監督の雪降って死ぬは、国際的なレベルで見ても、非常に成功した映画だと考えます。で、ヘレン・ノーリスの米国の監督が、シングルを、パーソナルベスト5のドキュメンタリーにも、入りましたということで、現在日本で、こういった成功にした、監督は原監督の他にもいますかと。
いないと思いますけどね。
I think there is no director like that.
What about Yanagimachi?
柳町はドラマで成功した監督だから。
He's a director who was successful in a drama movies, not in documentary.
But Godspeed You Black Emperor was documentary film, some kind of cult movie.
ブラックエンペラーはそんなに面白い映画じゃないもの。
I think it's not that movie is not that interesting.
Really? You don't respect it? Really? Why?
なぜですか。
Why って言われてもやっぱりインパクトなんて全然新軍と違うじゃないですか。
But if you compare
面白くないとは言わないよ。
I didn't say it's not interesting, but the impact it has on the public in comparison to my movie is a bit weaker, let's say.
So I think unfortunately we don't have plenty of timeThat's all for today. And thank you very much for your attention and thank you for coming. Mr. Hara, you were excellent. Thank you so much.
Unfortunately, I couldn't tell you all the more interesting stories I have.
その面白いお話ができなくて残念です。
And I'm very sorry for not having a time to tell you more amazing stories that I have.
Thank you.
はい、ありがとうございます。
Thank you.